the backcountry, there are three variables that control spoilage and loss of our fresh wild game meat, and they are the elements, temperature, and time. Manage these three conditions both simultaneously and continuously, and you'll maximize yield, minimize meat loss, and improve the taste of each animal you harvest in the future. My name is Larry Bartlett. I'm an author and a filmmaker, innovator, business owner, teacher, and citizen scientist. I started Pristine Ventures in 98 to ensure a career in the hunting industry. One of my professional ambitions over the past 20 years has focused on mitigating the risk of meat spoilage and ensuring hunters are well informed of maximum yield meat preservation strategies. Everyone with one of these books turn to page 339 and earmark it. That's 70 pages of everything I know about wilderness meat care. Anything I miss in the next 40 minutes will be in that book. Our hunting culture is aware that to best preserve wild game is to keep meat clean, cool, and dry. While that's the basic idea, expedition-style hunts, when fresh wild meat is 5 to 9 days from refrigeration and processing, require advanced knowledge of hunters regarding clean, cool, and dry. Basic knowledge is that hunters keep meat clean to minimize contact and spread of spoilage bacteria. We keep meat cool to slow the growth of bacteria, and keep meat dry to restrict the nutrients bacteria need to thrive. These three actions extend the shelf life of fresh meat. But there's an advanced science to wilderness meat care, and final taste and volume are determined by more than basic rules. Advanced knowledge is understanding the symbiotic link between storage conditions, i.e. the elements, and temperature, coupled with time. Mission accomplished if hunters use this information to develop more effective meat care strategies.
That's right. How'd you like to cut off a slab of that and throw it on the grill? Boy!
Hit down.
Final meat quality is decided by how calmly and quickly the animal expires and how thoroughly the muscles are drained of blood. This bull expired in less than 60 seconds and experienced significant blood loss. However, avoiding a deep dive into postmortem chemistry, just remember this critical point, that final meat taste and texture is affected by the ultimate pH of the muscle, which is influenced by stress hormones the animal experiences immediately before death. In stressed animals, you'll notice a high ultimate pH, which renders meat dark, firm, and dry, irregardless of how well we care for it in the field. After a quick, clean harvest, the next task is to manage the elements around our superheated grocery aisle to avoid contamination by exercising strict, clean removal of all edible meat. When dealing with the elements, an important acronym to remember, and an easy one, is asshole. That's right, asshole. Airflow, sunlight, storage temperature, water and humidity, organics, and length of storage timeline or exposure. We'll start with airflow. Airflow is important to dry the surface of the meat and reduce the temperatures surrounding the meat. The more airflow that you have, the better for the outcome of your meat. Adequate airflow is defined as a steady 0.75 meter per second or 1.7 mile per hour breeze moving around each meat bag.
Same shade, fresh coolness. It's like a mini refrigerator with this wind.
Sunlight is important because UV exposure excites cellular ions and speeds up the autolysis process. So the least amount of sunlight that touches your game bags, the better off for preservation of your meat.
Temperature in the shade, 79 degrees. Whew, that's hot.
Storage temperature is such an important category that it has its own next segment.
And all things good happen below 50 degrees when you're moose hunting, before and after the kill.
Water and humidity are linked together like the blowfly and the maggot. You really can't discuss one without considering the other. Remember that if the relative humidity is low, moisture evaporates more quickly and meat surfaces stay drier. In high humidity, evaporation is retarded and meat surfaces are moist. This increases the risk of bacterial spoilage.
98. So it's only come down about 3 degrees in 3 hours.
But in a properly controlled field setting, meat will lose up to 10% of its starting weight through evaporation and cellular drainage. That's an incredible amount of weight loss after about 120 hours post-harvest, or between day 4 and 5. Now that we know the effects of humidity, we have to pair that discussion with water activity to really understand the elements we're combating to preserve our fresh meat. Very few properties are as important as water activity in predicting the survival of microorganisms in wild meat. Microorganisms have a limiting water activity level below which they will not grow. Water activity, not water content, determines the lower limit of microbial growth. Water activity is simply the ratio of vapor pressure of the water in meat compared to the vapor pressure of pure water. All you really need to know about water activity is that you want to foster evaporation and cooling to maximize water loss and drainage without drying your meat to jerky. Without a fancy instrument to gauge water activity, we hunters use observations and temperature to note when equilibrium has been achieved.
It's 48 hours post-harvest, about 42 degrees at the meat cache. Doing wonderfully. Sun's just starting to poke out. Excellent temperature. Just gonna give a sensory check to the meat real quick to check our status at 48 hours post-harvest.
Equilibrium between the liquid and the vapor phases implies the chemical potential is the same in both phases. All that to say, when vapor and temperature equilibrium are obtained, water activity is equal to the relative humidity of air surrounding the meat.
That's right.
Crescendo, please. I'll revisit this point in the next segment covering exposure timelines for meat care.
This is the perfect storage temperature for this meat, and we've got just a couple of days left in this adventure.
Organics include any natural elements that harbor or accelerate bacterial growth or autolysis. These include soil, wound drainage, feces, bile, rumen, leaves, and even the fat reserves left on game meat. With less than ideal weather and temperature conditions, all of these organics contribute to meat loss and or spoilage growth. These organic threats have to be physically mitigated on a continuous daily basis throughout field storage. I'll show you precisely how to do this during sensory checks in the last segment of this presentation. The length of time game meat is exposed to the elements before processing and freezing is known as storage timeline. The reason why length of exposure is so critical to control is that fresh meat has a finite shelf life outside the freezer.
To Mark's hind quarter.
And bacterial spoilage multiplies at alarming rates 3 times every hour in warm, moist conditions. For these reasons, an in-depth segment on storage timelines is coming up shortly.
What I've got to do is get down into that, because that wound channel is pretty nasty.
Alrighty, now that we have fully explored the elements remembered forever as asshole, we can move on with the acronym in our back pocket of knowledge to explain the clean and dry rules for meat preservation. Let's build on our understanding of those elements and apply a scientific approach to solve one of the greatest mysteries of meat care, storage temperature as it relates to time or length of exposure. The commercial meat industry defines cool as chilling a carcass to 39 degrees Fahrenheit within 4 hours post-slaughter. Then, maintain storage temperature between 39 and 43 degrees Fahrenheit for up to 12 days. I speak from experience when I suggest that is far from wilderness reality in August and September. For that reason, we hunters have to deal with slightly higher temperatures and wildly fluctuating variables of 24-hour temperatures, wind, moisture, and humidity, as well as the length of exposure timeline, all of which require our constant vigil until final processing. Think of the commercial standard as best-case scenario for shelf life based on strictly controlled storage temperature, airflow at 1.7 miles per hour, humidity at 80%, kept out of sunlight inside a sterile cooler. Make it a habit of rotating meat every hour, making sure that every edge gets ventilation, and here's why. It hadn't been off the carcass 12 hours. It's been in bags for, on this beach, let's see, noon, 8 hours. And temperatures this warm, already got maggot larvae. So you can imagine any exposed meat's gonna have maggots on it. So that is the challenge. Yeah, obviously we hunters have to hustle to stay ahead of our wild meat shelf life. A wilderness hunter's ideal cool standard is a temperature below 50 degrees Fahrenheit and above freezing. Best processed within 9 days post-harvest.
Well, the temperature is still about 35 degrees. We don't have any worries about insects, namely flies getting out and sneaking around, creeping around, dropping maggots on our meat. That threat comes when it's close to 50 degrees. Anytime it's above 50 degrees, you're gonna have to battle flies and bacteria a lot more than when it's 35 degrees.
To understand the cool rule of meat preservation, remember the three basic mechanisms that cause spoilage of meat are microbial growth, lipid oxidation, and enzymatic autolysis. Turns out microbial growth doesn't thrive in temperatures below 55 degrees Fahrenheit, and lipid oxidation and autolysis triggers at 60 degrees Fahrenheit. Having said that, storage time, moisture, and temperature control ultimately affect what state fresh meat is in when it exits a bush. To combat all spoilage mechanisms, follow this next segment closely and apply this knowledge to your next harvest. In 2007, I began charting ambient and deep tissue temperatures onto a timeline chronology from each kill site all the way to the field exit. This data reveals important cooling and equilibrium trends with wild meat that have helped me develop proficient meat preservation strategies, even with extreme backcountry conditions.
So it's getting about 25-minute rotations.
Hunters with this knowledge will have the power to mitigate spoilage and reliably predict storage temperature variables.
Got the facing hindquarter off. Let's see what temperature it is. I'm guessing it's a little over 100 degrees. Maybe a little under.
Boom, 100 degrees on the money. Daddy knows his temperatures. And in 36 hours, we're gonna see that under 50 degrees. But we got a lot of work to do in the meantime.
Four things that I'll discuss in the time segment include the expected rate of cooling, the equilibrium, spoilage bacteria mitigation, and shelf life of wild meat.
Well, it's the morning. Guess I'm a little sooty. Happy birthday, mother sucker.
47 years old with a little soot on daddy's face. Been calling moose this morning since 5:30 in my sleeping bag. It's 21 degrees. Cold as hell. Cold as the Arctic. No sign yet. I'm just gonna keep making noise about every 15 or 20 minutes and eat me a bagel and peanut butter and call it good. 21 degrees, day 7, September 17th, my beautiful birthday. Holla. Well, it's a done deal. Happy birthday to LB. We got a moose down. September 17th, 06 a.m. Daddy is one happy individual. Perfect size, too.
Well, we gotta check the status of this meat, i.e. our food. It's 49 degrees ambient. Last night it got down to, well, the lowest recorded temperature that I read was 20 degrees. Out of this deep core temperature, my guess is so the animal's been at 10 a.m. it would have been 24 hours, so it's 5 p.m. it's 7, it's 31 hours. We should be somewhere in the vicinity of 47, 48 degrees ambient or deep core temperature,
if not lower since it's been so cold. We've had good shade all day.
The expected rate of cooling of any fresh meat depends on the storage temperature range and the relative humidity. But there are some cooling trends to help us reliably predict deep core temperatures if we possess a simple kitchen thermometer and we use it to record ambient and deep core temps about every 12 hours from the time of harvest to the field exit. The starting temperature of fresh meat hot off the carcass is 100 degrees Fahrenheit. Expect rapid heat loss during the first 12 hours post-harvest, thanks to evaporation and convection. The expected rate of cooling in this phase is roughly 3.5 degrees per hour. So expect a 40 to 45 degree drop in core temperature at 12 hours post-harvest. Deep core readings are commonly between 55 and 58 degrees Fahrenheit at 12 hours post-harvest. For the first 12 hours, the goal is to expedite evaporation and cooling in a shaded and well-ventilated location. Game meat should never be transported during this exponential cooling phase unless critically necessary. During the first 12 hours, muscles have stiffened due to rigor mortis. As cellular glycolysis builds, glucose is converting to lactic acid in the muscles and will peak within the next 18 to 24 hours. Spoilage threat is extremely low during this phase because cellular chemistry and water activity are incredibly unstable. Any spoilage threat attached to the meat at this point is inactive until cellular activity and the final pH stabilize at 24 hours post-harvest. At 24 hours post-harvest, expect to see temperature readings near 50 degrees, and notice that the rate of cooling is slowed to a fraction of 1 degree per hour.
All right, we're at 20 hours post-harvest.
This decelerated rate of heat loss is our first clue that meat core temperatures are approaching a resting balance with the storage environment. The meat handler's focus during the first 24 hours is to maximize cooling and drying efforts, then mitigation of surface threats, and only then is transport a prudent next step. At this phase, rigor mortis has nearly peaked and meat has reached its maximum stiffness due to muscle contraction during glycolysis. By 36 hours post-harvest, core temperature reading should be under 50 degrees and meat has continued to cool about 5 degrees in 12 hours, if storage conditions and the elements are well managed. Any time between 24 and 36 hours post-harvest is the best time to complete a thorough sensory check of all meat surfaces. Sentry checks are performed at least twice a day to verify the edible status of all meat surfaces, including deep tissue core temperatures to help monitor bone sour threats.
Hear that?
That's what your game bags are supposed to do. Dry around your meat. Get this cleaned up. Get a deep tissue core temperature and let's see how we're doing.
54 degrees. That's good for 20 hours off the carcass.
Just I'm gonna remove anything that's looks suspicious and foreign material, debris, fat, anything that might spoil or is gonna be difficult to preserve out here. So that's what I'm gonna do right now. And a lot of these legs have good fat on them, but you wanna remove all that because it just won't stay. And that way the meat underneath will dry.
Common bacteria thrive in temperatures warmer than 50 degrees Fahrenheit, and colonies can double in volume every 20 minutes when temperatures are warmer than 60 degrees. Plus, bacteria also require a low acid environment and nutrients to grow. A hunter's next step is to remove surface fat, hair, and dirt, debride the wound channels, and all potential source contaminants. After these steps, citric acid can be applied to shock the meat surface and any bacteria that still remains with a high acid mixture to retard bacterial growth. This technique provides an edge with meat preservation.
There you go. Chunks like that, no need to keep. Let the birds eat it. All right, what I'm doing here is I'm gonna pour some citric acid. I usually buy citric acid by the half pound at any local feed store that sells horse food or other animal food. They usually have citric acid. You can order it online too. A quick Google search for citric acid powder. Don't get the granules, they don't dissolve very well. And for this little amount, probably half an ounce at the very most. Because it's only a 4 ounce spray bottle or six. Make sure that's a real acid concentration. Oh yeah, nice and acidic. Why don't you get one ready? Pick off all the hairs that you see. And let that dry real well before you flip it over. Side dry real well and then keep on moving.
The goal is to apply an acid mist of less than 2 pH because bacteria and blowflies develop when surface environments are 5.5 pH. Therefore, our target is 5 pH on all meat surfaces. Citric acid is not the be-all, end-all of meat preservation, but it does help a great deal in warm climates. After this initial dose, hunters should reapply another dose every other day when core temperatures are above 50 degrees Fahrenheit. Discontinue the use of citric acid after day 4, as studies show bacteria levels are generally stable at this point. As long as the meat remains dry and core temperatures are maintained near 50 degrees, you're good to go.
So the name of this game is anything that can hold moisture will and does. Remove the threat. Every time you do a thorough meat inspection, it needs to include smelling all surfaces.
Sentry checks include what you see what you smell, and what you feel on the surface, as well as what you know about deep tissue temperature status. And the meat handler must effectively manage each of these senses to make good, sound decisions about this food.
Making sure that it still smells like edible food, and if it starts to smell tainted, you better get busy removing the threat. The neck pieces have a lot of connective tissue and a lot of folds. And what you see here is that connective tissue with fat attached, and moisture and nastiness gets caught under this, under the surface. So this is why this kind of stuff is important to remove in the early trimming stages.
All right, what you see here is those inner loins above the lung. This is some belly skirt. This is neck meat. This is also neck meat. This is more belly skirt trimmed off in pieces. This is all the rib meat that Chachi has not eaten, and she will continue to do so. More belly skirt and the brisket. Got a little bit more trimming left to do on that, and then we're all done.
So that constituted about 45 minutes of work from start to finish. First temperature check, to all the trimming, to all the citric acid application. And right now it's just before it hits 50 degrees and the bugs start coming out. It's gonna let it get a crust on it before I rebag it into fresh bags. And sometime today we'll wash these old dirty bags and get them back in circulation day after tomorrow. And that cycle just repeats over and over every day. You got to be diligent with your meat out here. And with these temperatures, the environment is against you.
Bone sour can spoil an entire hindquarter, so diligent sensory checks are necessary when it's this warm. The early warning system is your nose. If it turns sour, debone that hindquarter immediately and trim away a half inch border around the bone. Then, spray it with citric acid and let it dry.
Good shape.
Carry on with your meat care duties. At 48 hours post-harvest, game meat achieves equilibrium with the storage environment. It's when the water activity in meat balances with the surrounding temperature and humidity. Core temperature readings are commonly between 1 and 3 degrees of the ambient temperatures at this point, and our goal is to maintain this status throughout the remaining field timeline. Water activity is still evaporating, but at a slower rate based entirely on the relative humidity and temperature variables around the meat. Once equilibrium has been obtained, mitigation of spoilage threats become even more important since bacteria have now a stable environment in which to thrive.
Keep an eye on this boy's junk. And if it starts stinking, which it is, I'll take it off. Because I don't want that to even think about spoiling my hindquarter. And if I get stopped, I think it's about a $100 fine if the officer doesn't buy that this is a bull. But with my documentation here, video-wise, I think I'll get away with sound preservation as opposed to malicious illegal conduct. So what you're looking at here is a wound channel. I'm quartering. The animal was quartering directly away from me. I was trying to sneak in a lung shot and hit his hindquarter instead. It was just a pass-through, but that wound channel still needs to be debrided, and you can see all of that. If it were warmer temperatures, we'd already have problems. I haven't been too concerned about it because it's been so cold, but today's the day to deal with all that trauma. It's all got to be removed down to fresh, viable tissue.
That'd be the wound channel right there. See those copper bits? Hair, dirt, trajectory damage, necrotic tissue that would have spoiled in warmer temperatures. What I've got to do is get down into that, because that wound channel is pretty nasty. So I'm just going to do it. Got to be able to clean that out. Look at all that hair and nasty down in there. In extreme cases, I'll just sprinkle a little citric acid in a wound channel like that instead of spraying it with more moisture. There's plenty of moisture left in the wound, and that way get a good jump start on killing that bacteria or slowing it down. That way we can trim the rest when we get back home. And that'll give you a good acid environment temporarily. But that's the only citric acid we've needed. I think it'll be fine.
After 48 hours post-harvest, mitigating spoilage threat requires repetitive action to keep meat clean, cool, and dry. Meat bag rotations should be cycled several times each day to foster evaporation, convection, and drainage from all sides. And all meat services should be checked for odor changes every time they are moved. Game bag material can sour and does become an organic threat, so they should be washed when necessary or swapped out for new ones to keep meat fresh.
Cool thing about the tag bags is that you can take a perfectly bloody and otherwise soiled game bag and wash it in the river with quickness. And have a fresh, clean, dry game bag in about a half an hour. Wash them every couple of days. Rotate them with fresh bags or meat there, and have your meat will definitely taste better once it gets home. Nice, generally white bag.
At 72 hours post-harvest, deep core temperature should be within 1 and 3 degrees of the ambient temperatures. Rigor mortis is complete and the muscles of wild game are by now relaxed edible meat.
The type of ground cache you construct isn't really that important in terms of design, as long as it has a couple of important features. And you can see those were just felled trees that washed up and collected here. And we just use them as two poles, basically, laying parallel to one another. And put the meat on top of that so that airflow underneath was guaranteed. So you're effectively
providing airflow underneath and on top and all the other sides. And in here we accomplish the same goal by using, I don't know, 15, 18 willows laid side by side. It gives you about a 4-inch loft with airflow perfectly underneath, and drainage is allowed. That way when your tarp is back in place and you use willows to pop up the tent, keep the resting tarp off the bags, you've got airflow, shade, and adequate protection.
After 120 hours or 5 days post-harvest, wild meat has achieved maximum cellular drainage and should result in a net weight loss of 10 to 14% of the initial harvest weight, thanks to gravity and evaporation. Field exit strategy will dictate when final processing can be achieved, but even the best cared for wild game will eventually rot outside the freezer. Scientifically, there is no need to age wild game longer than 2 to 3 days post rigor mortis or 6 days post harvest.
He's carrying about 800 pounds. We figured 500 pounds of meat, 200 for him, 40 pounds for the raft, and about 60 pounds of gear. And the horns are about 250 pounds. I guess that doesn't add up to 800. But we're figuring about 800 pounds. That's a lot of weight. But he's doing it. With about a 5-inch draft, we figured.